Freshet Books Ireland presents A Kennedy Affair by Emily Hourican, read by Rebecca Lee. Cast of characters: Kathleen Kick Kennedy, Joe Kennedy Jr., Kick's older brother; Rosemary Rosie Kennedy, Kick's older sister; Rose Kennedy, Kick's mother; Joe Kennedy Sr., Kick's father; Lady Bridget Guinness; Honor Shannon, née Guinness, Bridget's older sister; Henry Shannon, Chips, American diarist and politician, Honor's husband; Prince Frederick George William Christopher of Prussia, Fritzy; Lady Iva, Bridget and Honor's mother; Will, patient at hospital where Bridget works; Sissy Maddington; Edie, Kick's fellow Red Cross volunteer, or Donut Dolly; Peter, friend of Sissy's; Maureen Hamilton Temple Blackwood, née Guinness, Marchioness of Dufferin and Ava, Bridget and Honor's cousin; Basil Hamilton Temple Blackwood, Duff, fourth Marquis of Dufferin and Ava, Maureen's husband; Caroline Blackwood, Maureen and Duff's eldest daughter; William, Billy Cavendish, Marquis of Hartington; Andrew Cavendish, Billy's brother; Debo Mitford, friend of Kick and Honor's, Andrew's wife; Edward Cavendish, Duke of Devonshire, Billy's father; Lady Mary Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire, Mouché, Billy's mother. The historical figures featured in this novel are based on fact, but as imagined by the author. Apart from the documented historical figures and events, this book, its characters and their actions, are the work of the author's imagination. Part 1, July 1941. Chapter 1, Kick, Hyannisport, Massachusetts, USA. The light was already as bright as a bare electric bulb, although it was only 7 o'clock. Kick threw off the covers and sat upright. She could smell smoke from last night's beach bonfire on her hair and remembered the crackling flames that had flickered across the faces of her companions. Those summer friends who were as much a part of holidays at Hyannisport as sailing and swimming. Her brother Jack's face, lit up and merry as he told a story from his recent Harvard graduation. Joe, so quick to cut in and tell his own story, a bigger, better one. The girls on either side of those brothers of hers who had laughed and urged them on. One, especially, newly come from Boston, a friend of a friend, who couldn't seem to make up her mind between them, flirting with both. Kick yawned. They had come home when dawn was already throwing out pinkish streaks, like grappling hooks, to attach itself to land and pull against the dark. But for Kick, used to being woken at 6 every morning at her convent school, there was still something decadent about lying in till 7. In any case, their mother would never allow anyone to sleep longer. Breakfast was at 8 sharp every morning, even Sunday. And if you missed it, well, cook was under strict instructions not to slip you so much as a slice of bread. "If you're late for meals, you go without," Rose said. Kick rolled her shoulders back. They were tight. All that sailing the day before. They would be even more sore by the evening, she knew. A race was planned, first to the Gull Rock and back. They did it every year, had done since they each turned, what, 8? 9? They'd set off in their separate sailboats, as many of them as were deemed old enough to go, rounding the rock as close and tight as they dared, then home again to where their father waited on the dock, ready to judge the winner and give his verdict on their performances. "Rosie," Kit called across to her sister, in the bed on the other side of the room. Rosie slept, as always, curled into a tight ball, so that only the top of her head poked out of the crisp cotton quilt that was patterned with tiny pink and white flowers. Rosie slept later than any of them and was the grumpiest in the mornings. "Rosie, we should get up." "You get up," Rosie called back. She hadn't moved and the words were muffled. Her dark hair spilled from the top of the tightly bundled quilt. "Come on, Rosie Posey. You know Mother will only be fretting and fidgeting if we don't go down for breakfast.
I won't have any lazy Susans in this house, she mimicked.
That made Rosie laugh, unwillingly. She pushed back the quilt and heaved herself up. Her eyes were swollen and her face puffy. Rosie was by far the prettiest of them, but you wouldn't know it in the mornings, Kick thought. With a grin, she hid carefully by turning her head towards the window. Rosie didn't like being laughed at, not anymore. Before, she would join in, eager for any joke, but this last year she'd been so touchy. Rosie swung her legs over the side of the bed and sat, yawning and stretching, with her feet flat on the bare wooden floor. Sun from the window glanced across the top of her head. Kick got up, put on her dressing gown and threw Rosie's across to her. She walked to the window and pushed it open, breathing in the sea air that was as much salt as anything else. Those birds must have the same kind of mother we do, she said with a laugh. They're mighty busy. Rosie laughed too. It's a beautiful day, she said, in the monotone she affected when she imitated their mother. We don't want to waste a second of it. She stretched and yawned again.
But it's too early for mother's moralizing.
My head's telling me I should be asleep. You can't be as tired as I am, Kick said, trying to cheer her. I think I only slept about 2 hours. It was the wrong thing to say. She knew it immediately from the way Rosie's face scrunched up, cross and resentful. I wanted to go to that party, she said. Older than Kick by nearly 2 years, she was almost 23 and had come to resent all that Kick was allowed to do and she wasn't. It wasn't a party, it really wasn't, Kick said hurriedly. Just a bonfire on the beach and a few of the same people we see every day. You don't even like them very much. I like Glenn, Rosie said, her face lighting up momentarily. Glenn was a friend of Joe's, handsome and sporty. Rosie wasn't the only girl who liked him, Kick knew. In fact, she had once kind of liked him herself. But that was before England, before Billy. Glenn wasn't there, Kick said. It was a lie, and she felt hot under the arms as she told it. She would confess it later, she promised herself. Right now, it was the smart thing to do. No Glenn, and no one interesting at all, really. Come on, we'd better hurry. They dressed and ran downstairs, arriving at the breakfast table just after their father. They were the last. All the other children were seated in their places, and Rose was ready to say morning grace. She bowed her head as Rosie and Kick slid into their seats.
Who's sailing this morning?
Their father asked when prayers were over. Only Bobby said yes. The race was that afternoon, and the rest of them decided to spend the morning doing other things, tennis, swimming. Who will play rounders with me? Jean asked.
I will, Kick said. If Teddy and Rosie do.
It was her way of trying to ensure Rosie did something. Too often that summer, Rose had found fault with her eldest daughter for not doing anything. More and more, Rosie wanted to spend her days just lying on a striped towel on the beach, sunning herself. Not even reading, as Rose said in displeasure. She didn't have the same need as the rest of them to be always in motion, doing and proving themselves. It wouldn't have mattered, except that it mattered to their mother. Idle hands, idle mind, she would say, disapproving. She would chivy Rosie to do something and Rosie would refuse, and then there would be an argument. There had been more lately. Rosie was so stubborn, but Kick hated to see how upset she got and how her rages would fly so quickly out of control. They all had tempers. They were Kennedys. But even little Teddy controlled his better than Rosie did. She let fly and was so upset afterwards that she couldn't seem to calm herself down, pacing and ranting that things were unfair and people mean, long past the time the argument should have been forgotten. Because while it was okay to lose your temper, bearing a grudge was not. That was unmanly, even for the girls.
All right, Rosie said now. I'll play. Kick smiled at her, and Rosie grinned back.
I'm trying to get in her good books so she'll let me go out with you and the boys tonight, she whispered, leaning close.
Kick's heart sank. She didn't think it would work, but she didn't say so.
Good, she said.
They dispersed as soon as breakfast was over. Joe, for all that he'd said he was playing tennis, went to the beach club to meet Clarice, the girl from the bonfire. He made sure to tell Jack how she'd telephoned first thing to ask if he had seen a headscarf she'd lost.
I'll bet that scarf is in her pocket right this minute, he added.
The morning was hot and bright and perfect. Kick, Rosie, and the younger ones ran about the beach until they were exhausted, diving into the ocean to cool off, then flopping down onto the warm sand to dry.
I'm going to wear my new dress with the blue stripes, Rosie said.
She had continued to talk about the evening, how she would do her hair, whether she might get away with wearing lipstick. Kick felt worse and worse. She resolved to talk to their mother privately and try to enlist Jack to help her.
If we say we'll look after her, she said to Jack when she got him alone, maybe mother will let her.
They were in the downstairs cloakroom, good-naturedly jostling one another at the wash basin as they washed hands. The slanting window beyond Jack showed stripes of yellow and blue, sand and sea, and the wooden shutters were so warped by years of wet, salty air that they no longer closed.
Okay, he said, but you have to say it to Joe and get him to agree.
Joe would be less inclined than Jack. He felt Rosie needed too much looking after, and she came out with strange remarks that made other people laugh, but sometimes fall silent in embarrassment.
He's more against taking her out than ever since she made that pass at Glen.
She was only dancing with him, Kick said.
That had been at their house maybe 2 weeks ago now. A small party, not even a party, just a couple of friends and some records.
He said she put her hands all over him and he didn't know what to do, Jack said, grimacing a little as he spoke.
He just needs to tell her no and not be silly about it, Kick said. That's just Rosie,
she giggled. I think it's funny when she does it. Glenn didn't think it was so funny.
Neither did Joe when Glenn told him. He said Rosie had better learn to behave, or he'll start agreeing with Mother that she can't be allowed to do the same things as the rest of us.
But can't he see that the less Mother lets her, the more she wants to? If Rosie was allowed to go out with us, even Eunice's sometimes, she'd soon learn it isn't all that wonderful, just a bunch of kids.
Is that what it seems like to you now after England? He asked with a sly grin. I suppose after coming out balls and being presented at court, a game of baseball must seem silly all right.
Don't, Kick said, drying her hands and leaving faint streaks on the blue and white striped towel. I get enough of that from Molly and my other friends. They all watch like hawks in case I say something that suggests England's better, and then they pounce.
She rearranged the towel to hide the stains.
Anyway, I'll watch Rosie tonight, she continued, if you help me persuade Joe.
Well, okay, but I don't think much of your plan. Rosie doesn't learn like other people, you know that. She's not going to tire of going out, not when she's got Glenn to put her hands all over.
He grinned and flicked water at Kick, who swiftly held up the striped towel as a shield.
Any luck with England? He asked.
None. Kick handed him the towel. I tried and tried again. They just will not let me go back.
I tried too. I told Pa I didn't think the newspapers would be half so mean to you as he thinks, with you being a girl and all. They were real mean when we left. All those headlines about what cowards we were to run away from war, she said ruefully.
Sure, but mostly they blamed him for sending you away. Not you for leaving. Everyone knew how much you wanted to stay.
I really did, she said. Then, eagerly, anyway, what did Pa say to that?
The same as ever. That part of our lives is done now. that he's no longer ambassador, and England is now at war, and that's nothing to do with us. That the best thing we can do as a country and as a family is to stay well away. Oh. She was glum after the momentary surge of hope.
Well, thanks for trying.
Do you really want to go back? He asked curiously. After almost 2 years? Isn't it all just like a beautiful dream now, and best left that way?
No, I know I'll go back. I'm certain of it. I just wish it was sooner rather than later.
Now that all my poor English friends are so much in need of cheering up. You mean Billy, don't you?
I suppose I do.
She had spent so many months back in America longing for Billy. Longing for London and her London friends, and for the person she was with them. Somehow, unlike the Kick she had grown up as, the wholesome girl who was first and foremost a sister and a daughter. From the very moment the family had disembarked at Southampton in March 1938, the English press had chosen her to make a fuss of. More even than her father, it had been Kick the camera bulbs flashed for. Kick, who was written and talked about. Billy had been the coming together of all of it. His instant attraction to her had been flattering and welcome, but she hadn't been terribly serious about him until she realized, when Debo Mitford told her, that he would never offer to marry her.
He can't, absolutely can't, Debo had said, oddly precise for one who spoke mostly in charming riddles. It's not even that his family won't allow it. It's that Billy himself would never begin to consider it. He likes you, oh, we can all see that. But he won't allow himself to be serious about you. If you ask me, she had continued, it's only because war is on the way that he's even let it go this far.
Like before a half-day holiday, when everyone gets real giddy? Kick had asked. She had been curious and a little insulted.
Exactly.
It wasn't just that she was Catholic, Kick had discovered. It was her Irishness, too. Her father was so self-consciously Irish, marshalling the Irish Americans of Boston and delivering them to Roosevelt, proud as a cat with a dead bird. His Irishness was careful, expedient, like everything he was and did, so that Kick had never before thought there might be different kinds of Irish, even different islands. Joe Kennedy was vocal about his Irishness, yet had only been there once. He spoke of Irish freedom as something tangible to be chased like a football, but always at a remove, watched over from the fastness of Boston and America. Billy's family, meanwhile, had a home in Ireland, an actual castle in a place called Lismore. They visited often and talked of how much they loved it, yet they seemed to see a country almost without people when they spoke of it, and recoiled from any mention of freedom. Generations of their family had been appointed to positions of great power, there in a country that didn't want them, sworn to prevent the very thing Kick's father cheered for, Irish freedom.
Romeo and Juliet are a matchmaker's dream compared with you two, Jack had said when she first explained it to him.
The impossibility of it all was what made her really fall for Billy. It had made her certain where she had been uncertain. The knowledge that he would likely not propose had made her determined that he would. It was a game, until it wasn't a game. It had become the most serious thing in her life. It was when she realized that he loved her and would never ask her to marry him that she felt she understood him and loved him too. It had happened at the very end of her time in England, when the certainty of separation had made them both speak openly. Then war came, and they were roughly pulled apart. Through the years that they had been on opposite sides of a wide sea, it was Billy she had come to long for. Not the victory that his proposal would mean. Not anymore. Just Billy, with his quiet voice and clipped sentences, so much more eloquent when he wrote to her than he had ever been when they sat side by side or danced together at the Café de Paris. His letters carried a great deal about how he missed her, how he thought of her, without ever suggesting what could be done about it. He said he would never forget her, but didn't ask her to come back or propose ways for them to meet,
which was how Kick knew that if there was to be anything for them, it was hope she would need to ignite.
Still, Jack asked sympathetically now. Still.
Better start to wear a hat then,
he said, looking past his own face in the mirror above the wash basin to hers.
Those freckles are not at all the thing for English girls, or girls who like English men.
They're the same as your freckles, she said.
Yes, but I'm not trying to marry a duke,
he said, only half joking now. Kick chose her moment carefully. Her mother had finished her 30 lengths, breaststroke, her head held out of the water in a flowery swimming hat to protect her hair, and sat by the side of the pool on a reclining chair with a pad of writing paper balanced on her knees. Standing above her, Kick caught the words, Bishop Spellman maintains that.
Mother, she began.
What is it, Kathleen?
Rose asked, looking up through dark glasses. Only her mother called her that.
May Rosie come out with us this evening, to the Brightman's party? Jack says he'll help keep an eye on her.
No, Kathleen, Rose returned to her letter.
But why not?
Kick was still standing so that Rose had to turn her head again to look up. With the sun behind her, she was a thin, dark shape placed on a backdrop of blue.
It's not suitable, Rose said, clear and precise.
Kick's younger sister Eunice had once said she thought their mother kept a tiny stone in her mouth at all times and spoke around it. Kick had known exactly what she meant.
But why? She won't be alone. I'll be there, Jack and Joe, too.
You know very well how Rosemary gets. She's excitable. She can be too much, especially nowadays. No, she's better off at home. Besides, you don't want to have to look out for her when you're with your friends.
I believe Peter Grace will be there.
By which Kick knew her mother hoped Peter Grace would be there, and that Kick would let him spend the evening at her side.
He might, she shrugged.
She kept her irritation hidden. Why must her mother, her father too, continue to parade Peter Grace and other rich Catholic boys before her as though she were a kitten to be distracted by a piece of dancing string? They knew very well that she wrote to Billy, hoped to return to him. And yet, they continued to suggest the sons of their friends as though her attention was as easily caught as a brisk wind with the correct tack of a sail. She clenched her teeth.
But I don't mind looking out for Rosie. I know how to do it so she doesn't exactly know about it.
She's not going, Kathleen. There are things you can do that Rosemary can't, and you will both have to learn to accept that.
But Rosie isn't learning. It's making her unhappy.
Kick sat down on the seat beside her mother, pushing her faded pink hat off her face. She hoped that sitting would encourage Rose to talk to her, to explain things, rather than just issue crisp orders.
You've seen how different she's been lately. We all have. She's angry about things she used not to notice so much, like everything that me and Eunice and I, her mother corrected. Eunice and I get to do that she doesn't, even though we're younger.
Kick clasped her hands, an appeal for her mother to listen.
She just wants to do what we do, and she can if we watch her. Surely she can. We can dilute her.
She laughed a little, mostly to see if her mother would laugh with her. She didn't.
That's not what will happen. Rather than you all diluting her, Rosemary will tarnish you.
Kick flinched at the word.
That's what your father says, and he's correct. She is altogether too forward now. She can't be trusted not to say and do things that are not at all suitable.
Rose smoothed a hand over her perfectly set hair.
And everything she does reflects on all of you. Your father is very clear that she mustn't be allowed to go around in a way that will be bad for you.
But it's only Rosie. Everyone here knows what she's like.
They do not. And your father doesn't wish them to.
Rosemary will have a different path,
Rose said, her voice softening a little.
That will be a cross for her, but she must resign herself to it and bear it, same as we must all bear the hardships that come to us.
You, Kathleen, I have noticed, have been trying very hard to bear your own cross. Did her voice soften a tiny bit? You may think I don't see the effort you make, but I do. I have prayed that you would learn acceptance, Rose continued, and you have. I prayed for it too, Kick said. She didn't add that, so far, she had learned only to pretend to have found it. But all her prayers had shown her was the unwavering determination she felt that she would get back to Billy, somehow. As if her mother caught the tone of her thoughts, Rose then said, I know how much you want to ask your father again to let you return to England, and I have seen you hold yourself back from that. It's admirable. She patted Kick's hand briskly, her fingers knobbly with rings. Your friendship with Billy Cavendish took us all by surprise, Kathleen. All the difficulties of his religion and ours, the many obstacles in the way. It was no easy matter. And I have been impressed by your fortitude in understanding this. Fortitude was one of Rose's favorite compliments. She reached out to grasp Kick's hand once again, then picked up her pen and repositioned the writing pad against her knees. Kick stood up. The conversation was clearly over. She tried to find a way to tell Rosie, but there wasn't one. Not when her sister was so excited. Rosie had seemed to think permission was certain. She'd talked about what she would wear, who would be there, what they would do, the music they would listen to, the dancing. Kick said nothing. Bobby won the race by a handspan, as Pa said, and because of that, Cook made her special fluffernutter cookies. Dinner was animated. Bobby, because it was his first win, was allowed to talk them through his every move on the boat. For the one and only time, Pa said indulgently. He loved a new winner. There is nothing in the world so boring as the person who makes you relive every round, every stroke, every kick of the ball. Kick thought of her English friends and how they would solemnly describe a day's hunting, every hoofbeat, every hold-up, as though these were moves in an intricate ballet. After dinner, as they cleared their plates, Rosie said, Well, I'd better go up and change. You too, Kick. Change for what, Rosemary? Their mother asked. Already her tone was chilly, and Kick wondered why she had to sound like that. For the Brightman's party, Rosemary said. Her lower lip trembled, and she stuck it defiantly out. She knew, Kick realized. She knew what was coming. But being Rosemary, she tried to tough it out. We'd better hurry, or we'll be late. She started for the door of the dining room. Kick could feel her urgency, as though Rosie believed that if she could only get out that door and up the stairs, somehow her mother would let her go. She felt sick. She saw Jack, Joe, and Bobby slide out of the room by the door that led to the kitchen and hated them for it, but could hardly blame them. She'd have done the same if she could. No, Rosemary, Rose said. You will stay home this evening. I'm going to the party. Rosie said. I have a dress picked and everything. You will stay home, Rose repeated, voice icy now. Pa, Kick saw, had followed the boys out of the kitchen door. Of course he would, she thought. The rule was his, its enforcement was up to Mother. Kick, you say I can come, don't you? Rosie appealed to her. It's not Kathleen's decision to make. Rose said. Kick stood helpless as Rosie looked pleadingly at her, her eyes filled with angry tears that spilled out and down her cheeks, seeming to take the blue with them. Kick? She asked, voice wobbling. I'm sorry, Rosie, Kick whispered. We'll go somewhere tomorrow, just the two of us, I promise. Stay home with me, Eunice said, trying to make it sound like a choice Rosie might make. We'll have our own better fun. I want to go to the party. Rosie looked at them all one after another, finally turning to face Teddy and Jean, who stood behind their chairs, hands resting on the wooden backs, as though pinned there. No parties, Rose snapped. Rosie shouted,
I will go, and you can't stop me.
Edward, will you call Kiku, please?
Kiku was the nanny who had minded all of them and now just had the care of Teddy and Jean. She was an Irish woman with great, strong arms, as liable to slap as she was to hug, to bellow angrily as she was to sing snatches of Willie McBride. Teddy ran from the room and Kick heard his feet thumping on the wooden stairs, driven by an urgency that didn't need to be voiced. Rosie was still shouting, "I will go!" She was trembling all over with rage and stared at their mother with a blazing anger that was almost hatred. Kick was relieved when Kiku came thundering in. She seemed to know exactly what to do and wrapped her arms tightly around Rosie in a way that must have been painful, though loving too.
"Hush now, Miss Rosemary," she said. "Don't be upsetting yourself."
Rosie struggled, but not for long. It was useless and she knew it.
"Come with me now, Alana," Kiku said, and she began to walk Rosie from the room, still with her arms around her, so that together they were ungainly, almost grotesque.
Eunice followed them. Their mother stood still and straight as a flagpole, and Kick wondered what colours would be run up, triumph or alarm. When they were gone, Kick tried once more.
"If we only stay a little while," she began.
"No, Kathleen. And I would appreciate it if you didn't give false hope to your sister. She cannot go, and that is that."
"Perhaps I won't go either," Kick said.
She was so tired, she realized. The sun, the swimming, rounders, the race, most of all, Rosie.
"I know Peter Grace is particularly looking forward to seeing you," Rose said. "You should go."
When she went upstairs, Rosie refused to speak to her. She wouldn't answer when Kick tried to tell her things they might do tomorrow, walks and picnics and even a trip to the drugstore in Hyannis. Just lay silent on her bed, face down. In the end, Kick did go, mostly because she couldn't bear an evening of Rosie not speaking to her. Maybe once Kick was gone, she would forget about it and go down to play cards with Eunice. Sometimes she did forget. But the evening was spoiled. She asked Joe to take her home early and insisted even when he tried to make her wait another hour.
"She'll be asleep now anyway," Joe said as they drove the winding sea road back towards Hyannisport.
"Maybe, but I didn't want to stay out."
Kick tied her scarf more firmly under her chin. Joe's open-topped car was cold.
"Well, I'll drop you at the gate and you can walk the rest of the way. I want to get back to Miss Clarice of Boston. She wasn't pleased at all that you took me away."
"No, I saw that," Kick said.
She didn't say it, but the girl had seemed silly and selfish. Joe wouldn't see that, not when she had such shiny brown hair and soft pale skin. But when they reached the gate, the house that should have been in darkness was lit up. Lights were on in every window and shutters open so that the ones facing the ocean banged in the wind.
"Uh-oh," Joe said.
Instead of dropping her off, he drove to the back door. Eunice must have been watching for them, so swiftly did she appear on the porch.
"Rosie's gone," she said, leaning over the wooden rail.
"When?" Joe asked.
"We don't know. It was only when Mother went in to say prayers with her and found Rosie wasn't in her bed that anyone noticed."
It was their mother's habit, after an argument with one of her children, to go in before her own bedtime. Sometimes it meant waking them up and pray together for reconciliation. Strategic, Joe had once called it. No one is going to hold out when they've been dragged from sleep. But Kick had always thought it beautiful, willingly kneeling beside Rose and asking forgiveness with her in the quiet dark of her bedroom.
"When was that?" Joe asked now.
"About 40 minutes ago. We've looked all over the house and down as far as the beach."
"You're looking in the wrong places," Kick said swiftly.
"If Rosie's gone out, it's to town, not the beach."
"We'll go into Hyannis," Joe said.
Already he was turning the car.
"Joseph,"
their mother's voice stopped him.
"Where are you and Kathleen going?"
She had come out onto the porch and stood beside Eunice. Into town to see if we can find Rosie. I will come with you. Kick heard Joe breathe out, darn, audible to none but her. She knew what he meant. Without Rose, they might have been able to find Rosie, get her home, and maybe even cover up the exact circumstances of her finding. Now that was impossible. Whatever Rosie was doing, she would be caught. The drive to town was silent. Kick kept her eyes on the sides of the road and then the sidewalks, hoping they might yet intercept Rosie. Turn onto Pleasant Street, Rose said when they reached the main street. But the drugstore's that way, Joe said. Turn, Rose repeated. Then, there. She pointed to a bar that Kick had never been into. The yellow neon sign above the door said, beer, or rather, be. The R was broken. Joe parked and Kick nudged him to be quick. Seated in the middle between her mother and brother, there was no way she could get out before one of them did. She wanted it to be Joe first. Needed it to be Joe. But Rose swung her legs out of the low-slung car the minute Joe turned off the ignition, and Kick had to scramble after her. She reached the door of the bar at the same time as Rose and, by dint of pretending to open the door for her, managed to get inside first. Shades of brown and yellow. Brown leather booths lining one side, with wooden stools along the bar on the other side, and dim yellow light from low-watt bulbs in tin shades. The place was mostly empty, and it took only a minute to spot Rosie in the furthest booth. She was smoking a cigarette and laughing at something, head thrown back so her hair fell away from her face, which was lit up and glowing as Kick hadn't seen it for a long time. She was so beautiful. In front of her was a glass of beer, and opposite, a man in a brown check jacket, his back to Kick. As Kick watched, he reached forward and took Rosie's hand, the one holding the cigarette, and drew it towards him. Leaning down, he took a drag of Rosie's cigarette and exhaled into her face. The smoke curled, thick and possessive, towards her. Rosie smiled a flirtatious little smile. She lowered her eyelids. Where had she learned that? Kick wondered, half laughing. Rosie, Kick still thought she could get there first, could wrap this up, fold it down and contain it. Rosie looked up and saw her. Kick? The small flirtatious smile grew broad and cheery, then dropped. Rosie's eyes flickered from her face, and Kick heard her mother. Rosemary, your brother is in the car. Had Joe really stayed behind the wheel? Kick wondered. What a coward he sometimes was. I'll thank you to take your things and come now. But I don't want to. Rosie opened her eyes very wide. I'm having fun. This is my friend. Say hi, Mike. Mike turned and waved. Hi. Get into the car, Rosemary. Rose said again. Go join your brother. Rosie looked at Kick, face pleading. I want to stay. Kick, you could stay with me and Mike. Mike nodded, affable. You could. He agreed, moving over to make space. Kick shook her head sharply, then inclined it towards the door and the car. Rosie. In the car, Rosemary. Now, please. Rose had moved to stand beside Kick, half a head shorter, twice Kick's size in polite ferocity. We were just about to have another drink, Mike said. Me and Rosie, she's a nice girl. Where's the harm? She's 23, old enough to be out. Tell you what, he looked pleased. You tell me where you live, and I'll have her home later. My daughter may be 23, Rose placed the words carefully, but in some ways she is a child. Doesn't look like no child to me. Mike said, still affable. Mentally, she is a child, Rose said. Kick watched, helpless, as Rosie's face crumpled. All the knowing flirtation, the smiling invitation of moments ago, was gone. She looked indeed like a child, a sorrowing, lonely child. Which makes me wonder, Rose continued,
why a grown man like you should want to be here in her company.
It was Mike's turn to crumple.
She don't seem like no child to me, he said,
but already doubt was there.
I didn't know, he continued, looking from Rose to Rosie. How was I supposed to know?
She never said.
He shifted himself out of the booth, but his path to the door was too full of Kick and Rose. He turned, awkward in the tight space, and went the other way, towards the back of the bar. What would he do there? Kick wondered. Hide until they were gone? Probably.
Your things, Rosemary,
Rose said, turning away. Squashed into the tiny bucket seats of Joe's car, Rosie's legs were jammed against the back of his seat. She turned them sideways for more space and leaned against Kick.
You're wearing my cardigan, Kick said, not because she minded, only to take Rosie's mind off what had happened in the bar.
It's nicer than mine.
Rosie snuggled further in towards Kick and put her head on her shoulder. Her hair smelt not very clean. Rosie wasn't so good about washing anymore. That was another thing Mother complained about.
You can keep it.
Can I really?
Rosie lifted her head and grinned. Already she behaved as though the bar and Mike were forgotten. But they weren't, Kick knew. They were in there, along with the other things that had happened that summer. Times Rosie had been told no, times she had disobeyed, times she had run away. Never as bad as this. Never yet at night. By day to the drugstore or Dee's Cafe, bad, according to Rose, but not this bad. But those times had led to this time. Where would this lead? When Rosie was in bed and asleep at last, Kick went downstairs for a glass of water. Outside, the night was clear and the stars were high, small and mean. In the kitchen, she took a glass, filled it from the jug in the fridge. She turned to see her mother in the doorway. Neither of them had switched any lights on, so it was only by the neatness of her silhouette against the lamplight from the hallway beyond that Kick knew her.
I was just going to bed, Kick said.
She couldn't bear a conversation now, prayers even less.
You must be tired,
Rose agreed. Then, as Kick passed her,
please do not feel that you are responsible for Rosemary, Kathleen. You aren't.
I am.
But she seems so unhappy.
She is wayward, and that is making her unhappy.
I'm not sure it's that.
Kick tried to find more words, different words, to ask again for Rosie's freedom, to ask for kindness, tolerance.
She's just Rosie, she said.
It was the best she could do.
You are not to be concerned for Rosemary. Home is where she should be. This is where we will care for her. She will be all right in a little while, you'll see.
You'll look after her?
Of course we will. Whatever do you think?
There was an edge again to Rose's voice.
You have to trust me on this, Kathleen, she said,
and Kick knew there was no more to be done. Chapter 2. Bridget, London, England. Every morning was a reckoning, with damage, with loss, with what lay ahead. Bridget's walk from Belgrave Square, where she now lived at number 5 with her sister, Honor, and brother-in-law, Chips, because her parents' house had become the HQ of the War Refugee Committee, to St. Thomas's Hospital took her past several ARP air raid precautions, shelters, and at each she asked the same question.
What news?
Quiet night, was the response everywhere that day, from men and women whose gratitude was written in bright eyes and steady hands holding mugs of tea. For almost 2 months this had been the answer, quiet night or fairly quiet night. And because of that, these were no longer the men and women she remembered from the height of the Blitz. Then, exhaustion had been written grey and tight in every face. There had been mornings when Bridget had prayed that no spy was carrying tales back to Berlin of just how close the city was to collapse. London would never surrender, they all knew that, but she had learned in the months of heavy bombing that it might yet sink beneath the impossibility of keeping going when every night was chaos and terror, and every day the hopeless process of trying to put things to rights, sweeping up broken glass with battered brooms, piling fallen bricks neatly in stacks. She had stood close enough to strangers for them all to feel what no one would say. How much more of this can we take? And then came a lull. Whole nights when the Luftwaffe didn't drone overhead and drop destruction on them. Yes, there were still bad nights, but they were no longer strung close together like fat beads on a too tight necklace. Now the quiet nights outnumbered the busy ones. Even so, they didn't trust the pocket of peace that had unfolded around them. Any night might be the end of it. The near 10 months of bombardment had taken trust from them that 2 good months couldn't restore. So, every morning, Bridget asked everyone she met, "What news?" Her question wasn't just to reassure herself of where the city stood in relation to the active proof of war, the tally of homes destroyed, buildings damaged, lives lost. It was also to prepare herself for what lay ahead at the hospital. St. Thomas's had been bombed 6 times by now, and whole wings were no longer in use, with wards moved down to the basement where it was gloomy, even at midday. But around the damage, hospital life continued as usual, and Bridget needed to try to understand what kind of day she might expect. A response of busy night from the ARP wardens would mean beds already full of wounded, hurt by anything from burns and falling masonry to bicycle accidents in the treacle dark of the blackouts. Doctors who were underslept and short-tempered, nurses harried and snappish. Quiet night boded well, and meant she would have time to read the letters she carried in her pocket, handed to her by the butler, Andrews, on a silver tray earlier that morning. She walked slowly towards the back entrance of the hospital, breathing in the early morning summer air, feeling the sun on her face. It would be the last she'd see of daylight for 12 hours. Inside, she changed her shoes and took off her jacket, putting her outdoor items in the locker with her name on it. She tied a clean apron round her waist and pinned her hair firmly back before putting on the white cap. Around her, girls she knew and half knew were doing the same while the night shift changed in reverse, buttoning cardigans and lacing on walking shoes. "Morning, Bridget," said a dark girl with crossed front teeth as she brushed her hair out from its pins. "You must be glad to get off," Bridget said, adding, "Mary," politely, once she had remembered the girl's name. "You have no idea," Mary sighed, "though I'm not going home to peace or quiet. Mum's back with the little ones." Bridget vaguely knew that she had younger brothers and sisters who had been evacuated, but had trickled back into London. "And they'll be that noisy, I may as well be up with them as trying to sleep. I bet you can hardly imagine the din they make." Mary knew that Bridget lived with her older sister Honor and brother-in-law Chips Shannon to keep them company while their 8-year-old son Paul was safely in America. She didn't know the house had 10 bedrooms and 7 reception rooms, many as lavish and stuffed with objects and paintings as a gallery, with quarters below stairs that were like the hold of a vast ship. She may have known that Bridget's last name was Guinness, but was certainly unaware that her father was an earl who thought mostly about new ways of dairy farming, nor that Chips was an MP who thought mostly about parties. She knew that Bridget's brother Arthur was with the Royal Artillery because they talked sometimes about where he was stationed, but not that he was a Viscount. She knew what was necessary and cosy, an address, a family duty, a brother in uniform, no more than that. It was funny, Bridget thought, smoothing her apron, the illusion of intimacy between them all. They worked long hours together, chattering and gossiping about hospital dramas and their own lives. Who was walking out with whom? Who had got engaged? Who hadn't? Mostly they knew each other's home circumstances. But the wards were too busy, the breaks too short, perhaps the differences too great to confide. She could have told anyone who thought to ask where Mary lived, about the little brothers and sisters, the dead father and the mother who worked in a canning factory. But she didn't know Mary's favourite colour, what songs she sang in her bath, what dreams she held for after the war. She took out the letter she had carried without opening and slit the envelope with the scissors she kept in her apron. She sat on the narrow bench under her locker and unfolded it. My dear Bridget. Fritzy. She had known it would be him. By now she recognised his handwriting, the way he formed the B and G of her name. That was why she had taken the letter with her, rather than read it at the breakfast table.
Who writes to you so often from Hertfordshire?
Chips had asked idly, seeing the postmark.
A school friend, she had replied.
A school friend. Fritzy, Prince Friedrich of Prussia, had been the dearest wish of Chips's heart. So much so that he had first started hinting about a marriage 5 years ago, when Bridget was barely 16. At her coming out ball, he had seated the prince beside her, and each time Bridget had looked up, there Chips had been, watching them, smiling and nodding like one of those toys that wobbles back and forth. Positively sinister in his bland benignity, she had thought. And so, of course, she had refused to speak to the prince beyond the barest of politeness. And when Chips had engineered a week at his country estate, Kelvedon, that last summer before the war with both of them, along with Kit Kennedy and her parents, Bridget had been furious and had started by haughtily ignoring Fritzy of Prussia. Except that a week together had shown her that, beneath his tediously polished manners, he had worries and fears as rough and uncut as her own. She had even felt sorry when he spoke of his father, still chasing the title his grandfather had given up into the arms of Hitler. But then war, and with it a recalibration of Fritzy's worth. First he had been arrested. Inevitable, he had written, and I would scorn to return to Germany to avoid it. That was the first letter he had sent to her in secret. May I continue to write to you, he had begged. I do not know what will happen to me, but I should like to write if I may. And Bridget had said yes, even though Chips was by then cautioning her to have nothing to do with Fritzy.
We are exposed, he had said nervously, almost looking over his shoulder as he spoke. It is known that we have been friendly, very friendly, with him.
We? Bridget had asked, because who could have resisted? Surely you mean you.
All of us, Chips insisted. And how could one not? Such a dear boy. But it won't do. Not now.
She had tried pleading with Chips to speak for him. He won't go back to Germany, even though he would be safe there. Maybe you could explain that and they would leave him alone. But Chips wouldn't.
He is the king's godson, he said. If that isn't enough, nothing I can say will make a difference.
She had said yes to Fritzy, and nothing to Chips about the letters that came. After a spell in an internment camp on the Isle of Man, he had been sent to Canada, to another internment camp. In both, he wrote to her proudly, he was elected camp leader. He had sounded prouder of that than of any of his titles. His letters had been full of the day-to-day of camp life, what they ate, the hours they spent logging and laying roads, and very few questions about hers. She knew he wrote carefully, conscious of other readers. Every letter from the camps bore the oval stamp of the censor. But even so, there was a curiously impersonal quality to what he told her. She sometimes wondered if he even remembered her, or was writing just to feel that someone knew where he was and what he was doing. But then, if she was truthful, did she really remember him? When he came back to England, released somehow from the camps, he went straight to Hertfordshire, a place called Little Haddam, where he lived as simple George Mansfield, farmer. From there, he continued to write to her, details of crops, livestock, the tractor, animal feed. It made him more remote again, even more unknowable, so that when she wrote back, She never knew how much to tell him about Honor, Chips, her cousin Maureen, who he had met that week at Kelvedon and who came and went from London so that she was still a constant in Bridget's life. Fritzy knew these people, but George, perhaps, did not. It was confusing. But as those letters travelled back and forth, especially once he was settled back in England, they expanded in warmth and detail. Once away from the heavy scrutiny of the censor, he told her more of himself, and she reciprocated. Something grew between them. Kindness? Friendship? Whatever it was more than could be just put away. My dear Bridget, she leaned back. But better be quick, Mary said, rubbing thick white cream into her chapped hands. The smell of lanolin made Bridget feel sick. Matrons on the warpath. Matron was always on the warpath. Bridget folded the letter, put it into her locker, and filled her pail with scrubbing brush and cloth, carbolic soap and disinfectant. Her duties were cleaning, beds, floors, bathrooms, wounds, dressing injuries, taking temperatures, checking mood and morale. In the beginning, there had been a sense of camaraderie, of all in it together among the nurses, even when they were dry-eyed from lack of sleep after another night of bombs and the akaka-aka-ak of anti-aircraft guns. But that was mostly gone now. Whatever giddy spirit had animated the first year of the war was buried under the rubble of falling buildings and behind sleepless nights in underground shelters. Now it was simply routine and duty. Morning, she said cheerfully as she moved from bed to bed. She straightened pillows, tidied lockers, pulled sheets taut and crisp. She picked up charts, scanned them, wrote in them, placed them back. What's it like out there? The questions followed her. It was the same every morning, their eagerness to know what had happened to the city under cover of darkness. Quiet night, she said, again and again, dispensing reassurance along with pills and glasses of water. She enjoyed the rigid order of the hospital, in contrast with the mess outside. Even the makeshift wards in the basement had order imposed upon them. Beds spaced at precise intervals, identical pillows, identical blanket turns. The rooms were bleak, but their organisation careful. She moved easily between them, allowing the rhythm and routine to take over and lull her. The days passed quickly, she thought, days that would once have been hard to fill. A lunch, a dress fitting, cocktails, all the hours in between with nothing much to do. Now the hours slipped by, like fields seen from a moving train. It was this, more than anything, she had sought when she began her training 3 years ago. Purpose. Intent. Days that ended with a sense of something done rather than a headache brought on by the chatter and laughter of parties. She saved Will's ward for last. She hoped he would be awake. It was a gamble. Go early in the day, certain he would be up, but she would have little time to spare him. Or go later when her shift was almost done, but he might be tired. His was more a half ward, only 6 beds in a space that had once been a place to keep spare bed frames folded and stacked. These days, there were no spare beds. It was on the first floor, and light came in through the windows. To her surprise, Bridget saw that it was a bright, sunny day. The hours in the basement had made her think it must be dark. Will's bed was the last in the room, over by the end wall. He was sitting up, reading. He smiled when she came in, then bent his head again towards his book. Once she'd checked the other men, taken their temperatures and noted the results, Bridget sat down in the chair beside him. How was your day? He closed the book, one she had given him, Martin Chuzzlewit, and placed it on the locker beside the bed. He pushed himself up straighter and Bridget leaned over to pull the pillow behind his head into a better position. Not for the first time she wondered how he managed not to smell of hospital. The antiseptic and carbolic soap that lingered on everyone else seemed to find no purchase on him. He smelt of the warmth of sleep. Busy, she pulled a face. Matron, he smiled sympathetically. Matron, she agreed. You? As ever. Has Dr. Carr been? He has, Will shrugged. Nothing new to report. Will was a puzzle to the doctors. He had been in the army, had been wounded in North Africa, and sent home after weeks in a makeshift hospital had shown that his leg would never mend enough for him to walk properly again. Back in England, he had quickly adapted to a limp and a walking stick and taken a desk job at the Foreign Office. There he had been, he told her, perfectly happy, until a bombing raid caught him one night as he walked home. He had been trapped beneath a fallen wall for hours. When one of the rescue teams dug him out the next morning, he was as much dead as alive. Since then, most of his wounds had healed, except for the injuries to his damaged leg. Dr. Carr's theory was that the leg, semi-paralyzed, wasn't capable of healing itself, so the gash had to be cleaned and dressed twice a day. Because of that, he had been there longer than anyone now, months in which Bridget had grown to depend on the time she spent with him, finding in his friendship something she missed from the rest of her life. It was, she thought, the smallness of their conversations, no grand schemes as there would be with Chips, no planning and preparing in the way of Mama, nor Maureen's abrupt demands for entertainment. Not even the worries Honor brought to her, usually about her husband or her son. Just, how are you? How's your day? Simple questions, with answers he listened to closely. May I? She gestured towards the leg covered with the grey hospital blanket. Of course. She fetched clean, warm water and iodine and gently peeled back the covers. The leg might be slow to heal, resistant to movement, but that didn't mean it didn't transmit pain. She had seen how Will's mouth set in a line when the gauze was removed. Every time, there was the yellow pus of infection. No matter how often they cleaned it, they couldn't get ahead of the disease that spread its sticky layer over the deep, angry red of a wound the size of a powder compact. Will sat quietly while she wiped and dabbed, then rebandaged. He never protested, never volunteered any information beyond what he was asked for. Does that hurt? And that? Rarely asked questions. Whatever ailed his body, there was something that ailed his mind too. Bridget knew it, as clearly as if he had said so. She just didn't know what it was. When she had finished and had disposed of the basin with its dirty water, they talked, quietly, so as not to disturb the other men, about the day's newspaper, which Will had read and Bridget hadn't. He made a gentle joke about the hospital food, but shook his head when Bridget asked eagerly, "Can I bring you anything? A pot of apple jelly? Cook made some yesterday." "It would be too much like school," he said, hiding jars of jam in my locker, eating it with a spoon after lights out. "I tried to keep the newspaper for you," he said then, "but Mike next door wanted it." He met the man in the bed beside him, and then he was transferred. "Different ward or hospital?" Bridget asked automatically, looking at the empty bed beside Will's. "Hospital, I believe, so I'll have a new neighbour." Will had had many new neighbours. He was the only constant among beds that turned over faster than rooms at a cheap station hotel, he once joked, then apologised when he saw her blushing. "The army," he'd explained, "makes a man's language crude." "More books?" she asked now.
"Not yet. Chuzzlewit'll keep me going another few days."
"Are you sleeping any better?"
"Not really."
He hated to say no outright, she had learned, perhaps because she saw how it disappointed her. "But thanks to your light shade, I make do." By which he meant that he was able to read most of the night, thanks to the oriental screen Bridget had taken from the library at Belgrave Square. Made of wood and painted silk, it closed like a large hardback book and folded out to a four-sided screen. It had been one of Chips's endless curios and objects, bought on a whim, admired, then forgotten. By balancing it on his locker, Will could shield light from the bedside lamp so it didn't disturb his neighbours.
"Is it very bad, being so much awake?" she asked.
"Not at all. The hospital is always busy. People come and go through the night."
It was true. She sometimes did the night shift.
"And I have Chuzzlewit for company."
I thought someday I could get a chair and wheel you outside. The days are quite warm now.
Even as she spoke, she knew it was hopeless. Thank you, that's very kind. Maybe in a little while.
It almost sounded like yes, but Bridget knew it was no. Will didn't like to go outside. She didn't know if it was because he hated not being able to walk anywhere, if he was in too much pain to wish to move, or something else. On a good day, he might use crutches to get about the ward, but she couldn't persuade him to go further. He never had visitors, never received or wrote letters. No one knows I'm here, he said, when she asked if she could write to someone for him, adding, there's no one to know. Bridget began to blurt out, there must be someone, but stopped herself. Before the war, she would have done so. Back then, she'd believed that everyone had someone, of course they did. But she had seen too many who didn't, or no one they wanted to know where they were anyway. She had pieced together bits about Will's life. He was younger than her by a few months. There was a sister, older than Will and married, but mentioned only once and not again. She sat beside him now, not speaking, and took out the things that had accumulated in her apron pockets. These she ordered, re-rolling two bandages and pinning them neatly, wiping clean the neck of a bottle of mercurochrome, then rubbing at the red stains it left on her fingers. Will picked up Martin Chuzzlewit and turned a few pages. After a while, she stood up and said, see you tomorrow. See you tomorrow, he agreed, turning from his book to smile up at her. Chapter 3. Sissy, Wicklow, Ireland.
You never said.
Teresa Malloy spoke resentfully, looking up at the house in front of them. Ballycorrie lay in its usual slump, leaning forward as though it would escape from the wet hills behind it. Sissy couldn't blame it. She, too, longed to escape from those wet hills. She had known Teresa would say that, or something like it. When they had turned in through the stone gateposts and trudged up the long potholed driveway, Teresa had gone silent. Her chatter about the mistresses at school and the cold of the recreation room had sustained them on the walk from the railway station, but fell away to nothing before the stone and moss facade of Ballycorrie. She stared now at the six upper windows that frowned across the front, like a man with eyebrows nearly meeting in the middle, and the four long columns that held up the portico above the front door and muttered, "You could have said." She didn't see that the windows rattled in their rotten wooden sashes, that the columns were stained and weathered, so grimy that they were the same grey-brown as the mice that ran about the kitchens. Sissy thought of pointing out these defects to her, but realised there would be little point. Teresa was enjoying her resentment far too much.
Let's go in, Sissy said. Mother will be wondering where we are.
Mother wouldn't be wondering any such thing, but she wanted to get Teresa inside, where she couldn't see the full size of the house. But inside was the same. It wasn't the bulging wallpaper or spreading damp that Teresa noticed, only the few paintings that hadn't been sold, stern ancestors who looked out of gilt frames, and the size of the drawing room where Sissy took her to meet Mother. Mother was lying on a sofa with a shawl over her legs and a copy of an animal feed paper in her hands. She smiled vaguely and said, "How sweet," giving Teresa a limp hand to shake. Teresa took it silently, staring, and Sissy knew that at school Teresa would tell everyone that Sissy lived in a mansion and her mother was as beautiful as someone in a storybook. There was no point in trying to tell her about Mother. How her beauty was a thing to be hoarded, pennies against a rainy day, and used only where there was advantage to be got from it. Teresa had been given a glimpse of it, because new people always were, but Sissy had seen the quick summing up in Mother's eyes, and knew that Teresa, should she call again, would get no more. Any more than the damp and rot. Teresa couldn't see the coldness of the look Mother turned on Sissy, the silent inquiry, "Who is this?" Even though Sissy had asked permission to bring a friend home for tea, and reminded Mother when she set off for the station to meet Teresa. Not that Sissy had any friends. It was just how she phrased it. It was what the other girls at school called each other. None of them called Sissy a friend, but she had hoped Teresa's visit would help with that. Now that she was here, it seemed unlikely. "The girl will bring you tea in the nursery," Mother said to get rid of them. The girl was how she referred to the maid, who changed so often. The girls from the village disliked working at Ballycorrie, or having much to do with the Maddingtons, that Mother had long since stopped learning the new names. Tea was a poor affair. Although she was 16, Sissy usually had hers in the kitchen. She had long since found that the maids had much better cake than the wan slices of sponge sent to the drawing room, and the new girl, Sheila, resented bringing the tray upstairs to the nursery. Now the tea was lukewarm so that the milk sat greasily on top of it, and there was only bread and butter to go with it. When she asked, timidly, for cake, Sheila slammed the cups down and said, "There's a war on, or didn't you know?" "But not here," Sissy dared. "Only an emergency." "My father says it might as well be war," Teresa said importantly. "He's a solicitor." She didn't add anything else. She didn't need to. "What does your father do?" she asked then. Sissy blushed. What a question. It was the kind of thing Mother had warned her about when she'd started at that school 10 months ago. "I do hope you aren't going to become one of those people who talks about summer holidays and asks what people's fathers do." She had placed the word like someone putting a winning card on a table. Then to Sissy's father, "I don't see why she has to go at all. There's plenty for her to do here." Briefly, Sissy had wondered what on earth her mother could mean. There was nothing at all to do, even less now that most of the horses had been given away or sold, now that her brother, Toby, 2 years younger, had been sent to school in England, and now that Sissy was deemed too old to ramble about the countryside alone as she used to. In any case, her father had simply sighed and said, "You know why. We have talked about it. She'll have to earn her living one of these days, and she'll need an education." Then he'd changed the conversation quickly. Everyone knew that needing to earn a living was because Father had turned out to be not very good at business, as well as unlucky. He had made the wrong investments, bought the wrong horses, or the horses went lame. Even the chickens died so that the poultry farm he started ended in the sickly smell of decay and a mess of limp, feathery corpses. "Well, there's the farm," Sissy said now, in answer to Teresa's question. Really, it was more a few empty sheds and barns, but she had to say something. "Oh, a farmer." Teresa looked relieved. Sissy suspected that this information, a farmer, balanced out the house and its surroundings, even the score, as it were, putting Teresa and her solicitor father ahead. After that, Teresa grew bolder. She compared the kinds of things they had for tea in the red brick house by the green where she lived with the poor spread in front of them. When they had finished and went to walk about outside, she was alert to the dustiness of the motor car in the garage. It had been so long since there was any petrol for it that it had become woven about by spiders. "You should keep it under tarpaulin," she said. "Father gets an extra petrol allowance." Sissy quickly ran out of things to show her, so she took her to Mother's dressing room and let her look at the clothes. Mother's evening dresses and coats. Teresa exclaimed at how sweet everything was and tried on some of Mother's hats. Sissy watched her with a knot of fear in her stomach. Each time Teresa finished with something, Sissy put it back as exactly as she could, but she knew she would make a mistake. Impossible not to. "Come downstairs and tell me more about your brother," she begged at last. Teresa was now trying on Mother's amber brooch, pinning it this way and that on a silk shawl. Outside, the July afternoon had started to lose definition, blurring at the edges. Soon it would be time for Teresa's train. Sissy had heard her talk about her brother before. He was training to be a solicitor and would one day take over the family firm. "He's engaged to be married," Teresa said, so swiftly that Sissy blushed for both of them. But she was still content to walk downstairs, telling of the difficult exams this brother must do, how he planned to go to London for a time. London, Sissy thought wistfully. Imagine being able to swap this endless round of nothing for a place full of people. They sat on the front steps in the evening sun, the stone cold under them, and Teresa droned on about her brother. Sissy, arms folded around her bent knees, looked around at gardens and fields and hills that were as familiar as her own palms and as dull to her. She had seen them in every guise, the fresh green of spring, the brown burn of summer, the greys of autumn, and blue-white of winter frost, vanishing and reappearing through mist and rain. There was nothing they could do or show or offer her that she wanted to know or see. The idea that she would never see anything else, never know any roll of time beyond the rhythm of the seasons as they played out on this canvas of grass and gauze, appalled her.
"We'd better start for your train," she said. She needed to stand, to move, to walk briskly away from the thought that lay on her.
It'll only ever be this, never anywhere but here. Suddenly, for the first time, she was jealous of Teresa and her talk of the horse show, the weeks in Galway, a regatta her brother was to sail in. People complained that the emergency had made life duller, but it hadn't changed anything at Ballycorrie. Sissy walked home the long way from the station. She hoped the house would be busy with its own affairs, washing up dinner, banking fires against the summer evening chill, by the time she got in and that she could slip upstairs to her bed. But her timing was off. Mother had finished dinner, but had not yet drunk enough of the sherry she liked while she was playing her gramophone and thinking about the dances of her youth.
"You've been at my things," she said when Sissy went into the drawing room, ordered there by Sheila.
"It wasn't me, it was Teresa," Sissy blurted out. She knew immediately it was a mistake.
Mother's face twisted in fury.
"You let that common little chit dip her paws into my things."
Sissy said nothing. "Come here." Sissy walked forward, moving her body obediently, leaving as much of herself behind as she could. The bit of her she detached stayed by the door, watching as Mother, still sitting, reached around and took a window pole from the corner behind the sofa.
"Turn," she said.
Sissy did so. Mother hit her three times, drawing her arm far back each time so that the slender pole landed with crisp force. Watching Sissy admired the elegance of her movements, even as she saw herself flinch. Afterwards, she walked down to the stables to look for Tom, as she had ever since the evening he had found her there, crying after Mother had hit her with the poker. It wasn't the hitting that had made Sissy cry, just that the poker had been hot, so she was burned as well. Tom had put something on the burn that he used for the horses when the shafts of the carriage rubbed sore spots on their backs. It was an ointment he made himself. He wasn't much older than Sissy, and had been so slow to talk that people had thought him stupid. But he wasn't, Sissy had learned. He was just quiet. She wasn't crying this time, and she said nothing about the window pole. But Tom seemed to know why she was there and put a soft blanket over the straw bale for her to sit on, just as though he knew how the backs of her legs stung. Part 2, 1943. Chapter 4, Kick, New York Docks, USA, June. Only her father came to see her off, and after a while, Kick wished he hadn't. The activity around Queen Mary was so urgent, so unlike their first trip on that great ship, that it made her painfully aware of everything that had happened since that March, 5 years ago. How blithely then they had set sail, the Kennedy family, for an England that was unknown, scarce imagined, but friendly. Or so she had believed, and indeed, so she had found it. She thought, but only briefly, because here was too much clamour, of the year they had spent in London as family of the American ambassador, the people she had met, the friends she had made. She thought of Bridget Guinness, of Deborah Mitford, of Billy. She mustn't think of Billy, she told herself. Not yet. When she had heard of his engagement to Sally Norton, she had tried to take her hopes and pack them tightly away. She'd even believed she'd succeeded, until the news that he had broken the engagement showed her she had put nothing away. She still thought of him with a swoop of her heart that was part elation, part alarm.
"You sure you want to do this?" her father said. His grey-blue eyes travelled the dock, sizing up the ship drawn alongside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.